round of applause for you guys, quite frankly. This is often said, but I think it's true. My gosh, you could be anywhere else. It's a beautiful day outside. I took a walk from my hotel this morning, and it was pleasant. So you could be anywhere else, but you're here. So thank you. I hope that you find this useful and we get to have some fun together. So we're going to be talking about the secure software development framework, really understanding how we best design secure software systems, some of the pain points with the SDL, and then what we did to address those pain points, making some suggestions and recommendations with examples, and hopefully that is useful. And of course, if you've got any feedback, please let me know. We'd love to have your inputs as well. So let's see. Okay, so my friends, it's very wonderful to get a chance to work with your friends. So friends first, my friends and co-authors at Intel and at McAfee. Some of them pretty eccentric, but just fun people to work with. So a little bit, well, you've already had the blah, blah, blah. We don't need to bore you again about this stuff. Moving on. So the lawyers always say, I should say this, hey, I speak for myself, not Intel Corporation. One of my lovely sisters is a lawyer, so we're not going to say anything about lawyers. Lawyers are wonderful, wonderful people. So the targeted audience, engineers, architects, developers, security practitioners, managers, quite frankly, anyone who's interested in developing secure software systems. Expected outcomes. I don't know if something has cut out there, but a better understanding of the nuances of the SDL, some of the pain points, the ways it hurts, and then the benefits of using the SSDFs, lean techniques. As you see, who knows how fast this will go if I don't talk too much, but it's a pretty simple approach. It shouldn't be too, it should be pretty straightforward, quite frankly. So hey, I think I'm preaching to the choir here when we talk about here the software everywhere. And these two quotes by Norman Augustine and Peter and the guys really just highlights the complexity we see in our worlds these days. The first one speaking to how we're trending towards having trillions of devices, but I know I'm preaching to the choir. In terms of software, it's always increasing. That's just what I'm trying to capture here. Now the next point, software everywhere. Now, what I would go from our fridges to our cars, still the same concept. We've got software everywhere. And we keep getting more lines of code. If you look at just this eye chart, we've got a Linux kernel about 1.7 million lines of code and then going up. But still, you've got Firefox with 36 million plus lines of code. And the Ford truck, the average cars in 2010, as I don't remember my references, but they're in the slides. You see them if you get a chance to look at them. In the average car in 2010, with about 10 million lines of code, now you've got this wow truck in 2016, which has got 150 million lines of code. My gosh, that just blows my mind, quite frankly. And this, I think, is exciting. From Peter Zyko, aka Mudges, you can see the lines of code for the attackers or for the exploits, they tend to be small. And then you've got all this going on with the defensive systems. But quite frankly, it's not as though the attackers aren't doing a lot of stuff, but they want to execute. And when you want to execute, they want to execute, they don't want to be seen, they don't want to be caught, they keep it simple. So there might be a lot of work that goes on, but they keep it simple. So now when you're trying to defend all this attack surfaces, as we might talk about just a little bit later, yes, there is stuff to do, but the main point of this is just playing to the simplicity angle of SSDF. We talked about software. Now, how do we build software? We tend to have these product development processes, and that's too small. Hopefully, this is better, which help us to write and develop software. So we've got the waterfall, the sequence of steps, and these are abstractions, so to speak, abstractions of the waterfall, iterative, and then the continuous deployment model. So we go in steps, okay, requirements, architecture, design, code, all of that stuff. Then we've got the iterative model, whereby we really have this workhorse, which is the sprint, where you're doing design and coding and building and testing before integrating and all of that stuff. You could have integration within those, the iteration as well. I will be looking at how the essence of this then will be how do we put an SDL into different kinds of SDLCs? Then continuous deployment model, highly iterative. It goes, you really try and automate as your integration, your final pre-release tests and your deployment, you won't be able to deploy at the push of a button. So that's the main difference between this guy and the auto iterative model that I just showed. Now the SDL, the security development lifecycle, I think it came to the fore, shall we say, around 2004. One of the major proponents at the time was Microsoft. Now, not the only guys, but one of the major proponents at the time was Microsoft. And it's essentially security activities embedded in different stages of product development. Whether it be from architecture, design, how do you embed security activities into those different phases? There tends to be, oftentimes, this step-by-step explanation of the SDL. And we'll be talking about how that sometimes takes away or makes it difficult for us to embed that within other more iterative processes of product development. Now, the pains of the SDL, we'll go through some pains for starters. The first one is, developers are pretty smart. Like, let's see, how many developers do we have in the room? Okay, we've got a good number. How many, shall we say, security engineers or architects? Yeah, and some of you wear multiple hats as well. Now, there's just a lot going on. Developers oftentimes don't have time to understand the processes of the SDLC. We want to write and ship working code. I often say that I think software development is like the modern day factory line, where there's always stuff that needs to get done. Quite frankly. So there's always a task, and it's little time, shall we say, to breathe sometimes. Like people just want to write and ship working code. Now, related to this pain point is the fact that sometimes security engineers constrain the SDL, the security activities that should be done as we build and ship code, they constrain it to their specific understanding of the product of product development. It tends to be waterfallish, and it tends to be based on how they understand product development. Now, the interesting thing about that, of course, is that security engineers lose credibility when they put this SDL in terms of the SDLC and then interpret product development wrongly. Because engineers are pretty smart, and if you guys think something is off, you know, you kind of get that feeling right away, and then you begin to say, okay, maybe this is not it. And that loses credibility for the security engineers trying to work with the product team. Now, I dare say that there's something about humans. We just like it when stuff matches. There's something about that. We just, one thing matching with another, it's just, I think it's in our design, quite frankly. In fact, I've heard it said that when we think that someone is beautiful or we think someone is handsome, that usually what our brains are seeing is symmetry. So perhaps next time when you see someone and you want to say, oh, I think you're beautiful, or I think you're handsome, maybe you should tell them, I think you are very symmetrical. When I see you, I see symmetry. Maybe, who knows, maybe that would help us with all this, shall we say, pride or insecurity about looks. But knowing humans didn't just be about everyone wanting to be symmetrical. But given the two pain points we talked about before, it leads to this one, which is we don't, because developers constrain the SDL into perhaps a waterfall issue, or just the way they understand product development, even though they tend to work with different kinds of product development teams. Product developers themselves usually don't have the time to think about the definite processes and steps and all those angles. It's really about shipping working code. And then the mapping between both of them, not so clear. Who has seen this before? A lot of us have seen this before. What do you see when you look at this? Has anyone not seen this before, let's say? Okay, what do you see? Okay, you see it right away. So the problem with the SDL, you have the security activities that imply actions that need to be done. But oftentimes, so vulnerability testing, threat modeling, but it's open to interpretation what actually needs to get done or when it's actually done right. And that leads into the next pain point, which is inconsistencies in SDL execution. And sometimes I can't help myself with SDL and SDLC. So SDL, the security development lifecycle, SDLC, the software development lifecycle. I don't know why there's a C for the other one. Maybe it's just so we understand it better. But that inconsistency is just the pain point of things being open to interpretation. So you work with a team and you're saying, okay, I need you, what security architect says to product team. Product team says to security architect, shall I say, oh, we've done the SDL, we're ready to ship. What did you do? We did static analysis, and that's something I've heard. So we did static analysis, okay. So there is that ambiguity that we're hoping we can simplify with the SSDF. Now, coming into the SSDF as well, which is aimed really at creating a lean approach to the SDL, which is SDLC agnostic, which works for the waterfall, or shall we say iterative or continuous deployment models, it should be adaptable to those different models. And it should include some guidance about when to execute an activity and when the activity should be done again. And we'll be talking about that, because sometimes you do something, you've done an activity, you shift the product, or the product is changing in some way, when should you do something again? And it should be minimal, just because we're trying to focus on shipping working code. It solves the pain points that we just talked about. And then, as though you guys didn't get it already, I had to put in some pretty pictures in terms of the attributes. You know, has anyone ever heard what they call death by PowerPoint? Have you heard that term thrown around? Okay, so I figure if I'm going to kill you with PowerPoint, I might as well kill you with pretty pictures. So these are the crux of the SSDF. We've got some activities that need to get done. We've got some guidance about when they should be redone. And then we've also got guidance in terms of how to map them to different product development approaches. Now, you notice that on one side, you've got the when I use these guys, I get trigger happy, and I'm just pressing it all the time. So over here, you've got the activities, and over here, you've got to be when it should be performed. Quite frankly, sometimes we have SDL phases. So people, if you've worked the security development lifecycle trying to embed security activities into product development, you often hear of SDL phases, or I have. But that causes us to think in step by step, things gotta happen one after the other. But to avoid that thinking, we put the activities here and then we put it to be performed during. So whenever you're doing this, do this. Whenever you're doing architecture, do this. Whenever you're doing design, do this. Whenever you're doing validation, do this. Whenever you're doing coding, do this. So whenever that is, no matter whether you're doing them in sequence because it's waterfall, or you're doing it in iteration, or you're doing it in highly iterative model as you want to push things to production, whenever you're doing this, do this. I will go over them quickly. The first one is just establishing security and privacy constraints. So you've got a new feature, you've got a new project. What are the bounds within which you must operate? So for instance, what kind of customers do you have? What kind of data do you need? Do you need to do authentication for some reason? If you're doing authentication, do you need to use OAuth? If you're using OAuth, do you need to stand up your own, or do you need to use an external provider? All of this kind of establishing, shall we say, the rules of the game. And next up we have, as we architect, now, the table maps this together, but I didn't put it here. Perhaps I should have done that. But as we've established rules of the game, we're beginning to come up with an architecture. Now, as we architect, we want to start security right, even at that point, in terms of designing for security. So in terms of threat modeling, we're really trying to understand the architecture, understand the threats that are pertinent, the attackers that are pertinent, and then the mitigations to be built into that architecture, which would then be the security requirements. So the output of the threat model should be the security requirements. So you have a security requirement, like the example I gave before with OAuth, the design review then is, okay, you want to update your architecture in this way with these mitigations prevent against this attacker stealing this data. Now, how is that done? A closer look, shall we say, at the way a particular mitigation is to be implemented. And next up is, these days everyone, my gosh, we heavily develop with open-source components. And really just managing the security or the risk of those components. This, shall we say, is a bit of an interesting one because even though it starts at design, it often goes quite through to, shall we say, at least to the later testing. Because you oftentimes developers could establish the fact that, hey, I want to use this particular third-party components as you begin to design those mitigations or the architectural components. But while you develop, while you code, we notice that developers oftentimes have to switch one thing out or switch the other thing out. But how do you, just ensuring that we're aware of the risk and evaluating the risk of those components that we use. And the next one, this next two, just looking at the code. While we implement, looking at the code, static analysis, all of that stuff. And vulnerability testing. I don't like this diagram very much, but what I wanted to point out, quite frankly, is I like the way you can see these three arrows, one of them just coming and getting stuck, another one going another way, and one just, the green one just blasting right through, which is really just hammering away at the software and really testing for weaknesses. And lastly, pre-release, just ensuring, quite frankly, that the activities have been done and have been done properly, whether it be looking at the test results. In a continuous deployment model, this kind of step usually will be automated as well. Now, the core part of SSDF is, aside those activities and the mapping we showed earlier, is that there should be some guidance about when activities are done to be done again. Because often, usually you do an activity and it's completed, but the project scope changes, the architecture changes. When do you need to do stuff again? So this impacts the activities that have been completed, and then we have guidance really on that re-execution. So in the backup slides, for most of these activities, we've got the various revisitation guidance. When do you need to do stuff again? We've got some examples here with threat model and security architecture. So you've got an architecture, you've threat modeled it, you understand what the what you want to protect. You understand who cares about the information you want to protect. You understand the protections that need to be done. But now afterwards, whenever the requirements or the design changes, you probably need to go back to check the threat model. So the threat model, as many of these activities in and of themselves are, could be highly recursive. You do them, but you got to do them again. Because sometimes you do them and then you just park them. We've got another interesting one here, which is when you've got an architecture and it's changing slightly. So many times in our experiences with teams, I should say, we've defined an architecture, we've threat modeled it. When people understand sometimes that, okay, once it changes in a major way, you should possibly be looking at the threats again. But sometimes you also have this creep whereby the architecture and the product is changing ever so slightly over the course of months or a year. Perhaps you should go back to look at the threats and look at the mitigations that are pertinent. Vulnerability testing, anytime there are changes to design or implementation, you should perhaps be doing your testing again. If there is a new security feature, some new crypto that comes in, some other security functionality, how are you testing that? And the last two, just if we get attacked at the interfaces, so when the interfaces or the APIs change, and then last up, if some defect is realized during, if there's an incident that wasn't covered during, that wasn't found in validation, an incident that wasn't found perhaps doing any testing. Whether you find an incident during validation or perhaps even with an external PCert, you should perhaps check your testing once again. So now we try to map. And we're almost done here, quite frankly. We try to map these lean activities to the different SDLCs. For this guy, it's pretty straightforward. And I hope you can you see this at the back? So for this guy, it's pretty straightforward. We've got this abstraction of waterfall. We've got requirements and architecture and design. And you can see how we've got establishing privacy, security and privacy constraints, and the threat model and security architecture. As we design, we want to ensure that we doing, we're evaluating the security of design of the requirements and mitigations that come out of a threat model. Manual code review for any high risk or security sensitive code, even as you do some automated testing with static analysis. You've got managed third party components, which cuts across design and unit test. And then you've got static analysis also, even at integration and vulnerability testing. So this tends to be the waterfall-ish way of doing things. Whereby with, in an iterative model, you've still got these elements over here, but as you design and code and build and test, all this should be happening rather continuously in iterations. Perhaps you might even have your integration within the sprint. And you could have definitely, so you have your security, your threat model and security architecture, that could be done here. Perhaps a lot of it could be done in the sprint as well. But this happens continuously. And last but not least, we've got continuous deployment, which means we just want to be able to push stuff really fast to production. And in this case, that means, I guess the interesting piece to call out here then is that vulnerability testing should be automated. Because if one is trying to push a button and get your code to production, and I'm probably preaching to the choir, at that point you don't have time to begin to do manual vulnerability testing. So that means vulnerability testing, of course, static analysis at this point, and even pre-release review to evaluate the results of this testing should be automated as well. And looking back at these three files, you can see how this really lean, basic activities map to these various product development approaches. Now, how did this even solve the pain points that I went on about previously? So the first one, which I didn't mention, hopefully this doesn't make SSDF more clunky than it needs be, is a definition of roles and responsibilities. Who does what? So who leads the SDL? Who is responsible for closing the SDL? Who is responsible for doing domain-specific or domain activities that require domain expertise, like crypto? So those really helping us with this pain point of developers not understand the SDLC and the mapping between SDL and the product development process. And you see that some of these solutions will actually address the same pain points, and that's okay. So next up, code wins arguments. Has anyone heard this before? Anyone? So really just, it's something of a hacker mantra saying, okay, especially for us techie folks, we just want to get stuff done. So if we're just trying to get stuff done or we're focusing on getting stuff done, then we don't want the SDL to be another albatross on people's necks that they've got to grunt through, which often happens, but rather we want to streamline it such that it just works really with getting stuff done. And it addresses those two pain points with developers as sign of the SDLC and even how security engineers present the SDL, because now it's not about some specific way of product development. It's trying to put it in terms of the general product development approaches and still having the right information. And next up is what I just spoke about. I'll go through these ones pretty fast about when to do stuff again. It's very important that this activities are reconsidered as the product evolves. Usually, a lot of us perhaps use the iterative model or continuous deployment, and we dynamically have to be able to respond to our customers and still ensure that our products, while meeting those customer needs, are secure. This piece, which is part of the other one, is that oftentimes with high velocity releases, where you've got these minor tweaks, and the product is going out, something is changing, but just a reminder then that that should tie into security activities being done again. Now I call this, for the want of a better term, we just call this recommendation X, which is that when we consider the SDL as these activities that are recommendations of actions that should be performed, like I said before, it's open to interpretation. And that means sometimes someone, you have your top two teams go do vulnerability testing. Perhaps they need some security expert or security architect even for, say, a threat model. But they could have different levels of expertise or different skill sets, which leads to two teams perhaps doing different kinds of work. And really all this is pointing out is that it helps to extract, shall we say, based on the architecture, some architecture-specific requirements to go along with the broader security activity. So for instance, you've got a web app and you've got such a solution. How do you take care of, shall we say, XSS or CRSF? Or if you're developing a thick client C++ library, you know, what happens with memory management? What happens with memory leaks? What happens with buffer overflows? So some of those architecture solution specific requirements that add up to the security activities, making things less vague. Now there are different tools. There are some tools that help with this in the market. And then there are also, I also noticed that some companies actually have their custom requirements for these different kinds of solutions, architectures that are relevant for their business. And this helps with the ambiguity, really, of different product teams doing different levels of security, or really product teams just trying to check the box. Because when developers don't think something is necessary, or don't think it just works, or don't see the value, it becomes just a checkbox we put aside because we want to do stuff that makes sense. So this helps with that specificity of, okay, you've got this kind of architecture, you should perhaps be doing this as well. So you can add this recommendation X to the few lean activities that scale to different product development approaches. And that's really all I've got today. Thank you so much for coming out. Any questions? Oh, thank you.
Who wants a microphone?
Hopefully I didn't bore you too much.
So I work as an application penetration tester in a continuous deployment environment, and we run into a lot of problems that you addressed very quickly, saying you need automated vulnerability testing in that sort of environment. Problem that we're having is trying to sell that is actually beneficial enough to pay for it. And I was wondering if you have any recommendations for software or anything like that, or just arguments to throw at people with money so that we can try to get that software in-house.
I love that question because ultimately we need buy-in to get stuff done. It's a team, whether for those of us who are testing software, those of us who are developing, or those who are provisioning resources so that work gets done. So not to answer too vaguely, I think it'll be about the buy-in. So oftentimes we think about what needs to happen in terms of, okay, my role in this job and this work and how this work will be done right, but how does it help the business? So do you guys need to, for you running continuous deployment, there must be a reason why you need to get stuff shipped at the push of a button. Then of course, if security is important, then security should be part of that process. If not, you're pushing stuff really fast, that comes back to haunt you. Does that begin to answer the question? Because you probably know what I just said. It's really buying. It's really about making the case for why it helps the business and why not doing that causes a problem subsequently. They need to push things fast, and they've got to be able to push things fast securely. If not, why do it? You've got another question?
We're currently in a similar situation. So presenting the problem will accelerate buy-in, getting buy-in, if you present a solution first, you'll get into problems. So if you have a tool that you want to use, and you present that you want to use that tool, you will most likely not get buy-in. If you want buy-in, you have to present the problem first.
Thank you. Oh, my friend over there has got another question.
I was wondering what your estimation is, how much security resources are needed compared from a waterfall approach to an agile approach with many interactions and continuous deployment. Do you think it multiplies, or is it similar efforts that are needed from a security team, let's say?
That's a good question as well. And I know everyone says that's a good question. But you've got these different approaches of developing software. How do resources play into that? So I dare say, particularly, let's say with iterative models, things are changing dynamically. So you need people oftentimes, perhaps within the team, who can help with those activities. So something that's happened in my experience would be having what I call security satellites, and you perhaps have used similar approaches in your companies, whereby you have maybe a security architect or a security expert who works with volunteers within product teams to build up security expertise from within. So you could have multiple agile teams, but you're building up security experts, those who are interested, just volunteering resources, and that helps scale. So perhaps I think you'd need more resources than perhaps a step-by-step waterfall model, just because a lot of things are happening. And now when we think about continuous deployment, something that comes to my mind, and anyone can chime in if they've gone down and go, even if you think I'm wrong, will be that perhaps one, you need also resources for automation. So you need people who are able to, who are also within the teams doing security activities on the product, but you also need resources for developing tools that help the security engineers or the security volunteers and perform automation and get things moving smoothly. So some extra resources focused on automation and tool building in the continuous deployment space. Does that help? Thank you.
Any more questions?
Another question for Mark, the gentleman over here.
Hello. Do you have any models or good practices with working with vendors like third parties, not internally with developers? Do you put the security into the contract, or you work on the daily basis? How do you manage that?
I'm glad you asked, because these days we usually have to work. My gosh, I'm from Nigeria, and now I live in Arizona. And then I'm here. So, you know, we're just all over the place, and it's really, there's a lot of interaction across companies, across continents. But the question, though, is what kind of engagement with third parties are you talking about? I want you to clarify that, because the engagement with third parties, then the kind of engagement helps us to understand how we put security in conversation.
I mean, if you don't have development team internally, you have the development team that is the third party vendor, and you want to have your security involved into the development lifecycle. How do you manage that?
So that the cool thing, I guess, will be, not even I guess, so security has got to start early. The stats show that the later it takes to get security done, the more expensive it is. Now, obviously, you've done all this work. Subsequently, you find an issue, it's more expensive. So if security has got to start earlier, then one is thinking about, where is architecture happening, for starters? So is architecture happening within your company or within the third party? Shall we say, even stepping back from that, one has got to establish your security constraints, as we said earlier, the security constraints for that specific application or domain or data. But in addition to that, where are you doing architecture? You should be doing threat modeling. So you could either have perhaps a security architect in-house who works with someone on that third-party company, or it could even be, if you really want them to get heavier with security, perhaps you need to have, maybe it might be some people who take the approach of writing that up into the contract, such that they know ahead of time that these activities need to get done, or they need to have these particular resources, or that the product to be evaluated in a particular way. Does that begin to answer a question? Does it? So there are different approaches depending on how you engage. You could have resources that support or oversee their resources. You could write it into the contract so they know it has to get done. Things like that.
I just wanted to have a sort of clarification with regards to automation of testing. When it comes to an agile environment, if you just use automation, do you think it's enough, or do you need a more of a manual review as well? Because then generally you would be able to see potentially more issues when it comes to vulnerability or pen testing, et cetera. What do you think, is automation enough for even in an agile environment?
Okay. I think you're right, we gotta have a combination. So when you say manual, do you mean manual reviews of the code or just manual approaches to testing stuff?
As in testing when it comes to review, code review, plus pen testing and vulnerability analysis, et cetera.
Yeah, I think they'll go hand in hand, quite frankly.
Yeah.
So for instance, with code reviews, so we've got some cases, we've got millions of lines of code. Do we go look at all those lines of code? Perhaps we might not be able to do that. But we can then focus on the security sensitive function. Where are you processing data? You know, where do you need, where are you trying to do some encryption? Where are you doing crypto? Things like that. With testing as well, one is never gonna take away from, shall we say, the ingenuity of folks like yourselves when it comes at really whacking at a system. So I say they go hand in hand in the continuous deployment approach, or even agile, depending on how, shall we say, how efficient one wants the process should be, some of your testing should be part of your build and deployment pipeline. But still, pen testing is actually different from vulnerability testing if you're looking at stuff that just might not have been considered at all, even during the architecture. So some manual effort, particularly the higher risk a project is, will still be helpful. Thank you.
Oh, any more questions? Okay, big round of applause for Damilare.
Big round of applause for you guys.